All right. Hi, everybody. My name is Reyes Espinosa. And I'll go ahead and let you, Richard, introduce yourself.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Richard Brown.
So we're going to be talking about the paper that I wrote for Coastal University, Railton's Moral Properties and Sinclair's Critique of Them. So the way this is going to work is I'm going to talk for roughly 10, no more than 15 minutes, and then we're going to let Richard jump in and provide his commentary for the paper. So with that in mind, do you have anything else to say, Richard, before we start, or before I jump into it?
Nope, just that I'm happy to be here, looking forward to the discussion. So why don't you go ahead and get started?
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, so a little bit of background on the paper is, so usually when we think about ethics, we talk about normative ethics, questions of, what ought we do, what ought we not do. And my paper is on meta-ethics, which tries to figure out the standards of, for example, truth, conditions of moral claims. And the particular viewpoint that I'm going to that my paper talks about is this debate between, or the view of Peter Railton, and there's a critique by a philosopher, Neil Sinclair, who criticizes a portion of his meta-ethical account. And then, so in my paper, what I do is I respond to Sinclair's critique of it, of Railton. So in the end, I end up defending Railton. And end up tweaking his account a little bit to account for Sinclair's for Sinclair's criticism of it. All right. So what I'll do now is I'll explain Railton's view, the main points of it that I want to cover for my purposes. Then I'll cover Sinclair. Then I'll get to what I say about Sinclair. Okay. So Railton comes from a point of view of moral realism, where he wants two conditions to defend basically two conditions. One, that morality is independent from our judgments, and two, that there's a feedback condition that we're able to interact with morality in a certain way. And the way that he does this is through ethical naturalism. So what he ends up doing is what Railton gets at is he reduces moral properties to natural properties. So it's going to be taken as an assumption in my paper. I don't know if you're going to want to talk about this, Richard, but so the way the reduction happens is not really of concern to me so much. So I take that as a given. Because what Sinclair ends up saying is that even if we take Railton's reduction seriously and we grant everything, he thinks that in the end we're still Railton's conclusion still ends up being wrong. Okay, so what I want to get at first is what Railton thinks moral rightness is, and what I want to read from here is Railton thinks that moral rightness has to do a lot with social rationality. So let me talk about social rationality. A social point of view is taking into account the perspectives of more than one person, but it is crucial to Railton's conception of social rationality. An idealization of social rationality is what would be rationally approved of were the interests of all potentially affected individuals counted equally under the circumstances of full and vivid information. This definition is similar to what So at the end of the day, the main moral rightness ends up being approximation to social rationality, and moral wrongness becomes a deviation from social rationality. Okay, so again, so moral rightness for Railton is, I'm going to repeat it one more time, is an idealization of social rationality is what would be rationally approved of were the interests of all potentially affected individuals counted under equal circumstances of full and vivid information. Okay, so what Sinclair ends up criticizing from this is the following. Sinclair can imagine a situation where this definition doesn't hold. In a situation where rationally, where the instrumental, where individuals, where a certain kind of individual would disagree with this definition. Okay, so let me jump down here for a second. For Railton, he thinks that instrumentally rational people are people that take that definition into account. And so those are the types of people that that would agree with that definition. But again, Sinclair says, even if you take that definition for what it is, you're going to find situations where you're not going to, where these people are going to disagree with this definition. Okay, so let me read the following. Sinclair states, a ruling body might quite possibly be in a situation where whatever it does, the objective interest of some subset of its citizens would remain unsatisfied. Nevertheless, there may still be some decisions of such a body that would not be disapproved of by instrumentally rational people, considering equally the objective interest of all potentially affected individuals under conditions of full and vivid information. Okay. What Sinclair is saying here is, so if we take these socially rational people, there's going to be situations where they disapprove, where they would disagree with the definition of full and vivid information. Okay, so am I making myself clear there, Richard?
Yeah, I think that's clear.
Okay, great.
What's not clear is why he's doing it, I guess. So why is he imagining this kind of...
Why Sinclair is imagining it? So Sinclair ends up saying the following. He criticizes Railton's how Railton conceives of like a dispositional property. So what's moral rightness? Well, it's this disposition for to make the right decisions, the right judgments. And what Railton's it's this response dependent, but what Sinclair is saying that he criticizes that and that's something that in the paper that I put is okay, so I'm gonna grant Sinclair that this dispositional property doesn't work. Okay, so what if we go down another level, which is just the bare natural facts of the matter? So for example, a big part of Railton's account is objective interests. So the objective interest of a population. I like to use examples of for example, just basic healthcare or like, you know, humans need food. Because they're just the easiest to, you know, to wrap your head around. You know, when we start talking about psychological properties and things of that nature, you know, there's a lot more to object about. So let's talk of just at the basic level of health, even though there may be you know, other moral rights. So let's take a situation, for example, where a group of people. So you have a ruling body, right? You have a government, and you have the government has a certain amount of money, and they have to feed, you know, a certain amount of people. Let's say it's, you know, they're going through famine, and they only have a certain amount of money. Okay, so what the government has to do is choose how to allocate the funds. And depending on how they do that, right? So that's a situation. So an objective interest of that subset group of that subset of people is, you know, just receiving food. So I think that Sinclair is criticism of Railton is too. I think it's unreasonable, because okay. So with the ruling body example, that there's going to be a situation where the ruling body doesn't. You know, where the ruling body would not satisfy the objective interest of a group of people. So it's unrealistic for Sinclair to say, okay, so since they can't, so there, since there's this one situation, so it's not only that it's this one situation, it's that there's going to always be situations in life where we're not able to satisfy the objective interest of someone. And what I'm saying in the paper is, look, so if we take the circumstances as a whole, is what we, so you can't only look at the object, not satisfying the objective interest to be morally wrong. You got to look at other things around that situation. And that's what I try to argue in the paper, that Sinclair's critique is unreasonable, and no one is ever going to attain moral rightness if that's what we take to be the criterion. So I have a little bit more to say on that, but do you want to jump in here for a second, Richard?
I would just wish you could say a little bit more about what an objective interest is, what the distinction there is.
Okay, so Railton has three distinctions: subjective interests, objectified subjective interests, and objective interests. Okay, so subjective interest is the wants and desires of an individual, conscious or unconscious. That's what Railton takes subjective interest to be. From that, he says, okay, we can do a sort of, from here we can reduce to, or we can find a way to get to the objective interest of people. And how he does this is something that my paper doesn't really flesh out a lot, because Railton's been criticized on objectified subjective interest, and that's a whole debate all its own. So what I want to say on objectified subjective interest is, you know, for our audience really quick, is the following. So taking keeping the subjective interest in mind, the wants and desires of an agent, conscious or unconscious. Okay, so regular Lonnie is a person, let's say. Regular Lonnie is a traveler who, unbeknownst to him, is being followed by Lonnie Plus, where Lonnie Plus is regular Lonnie with special powers. Lonnie Plus has unqualified cognitive and imaginative powers and full factual and nomological information about regular Lonnie's physical and psychological constitution, capacities, circumstances, history, and so on. Also, his instrumental rationality is in no way defective. Instrumental rationality is choosing the appropriate act that would advance one's ends. The objectified subjective interest for the regular Lonnie are what Lonnie Plus would want regular Lonnie to have. Okay, so what the role that Lonnie Plus plays here is, whatever Lonnie Plus wants is the objectified subjective interest. Because Lonnie Plus has the unqualified cognitive, imaginative powers and full factual and nomological information about regular Lonnie's physical, psychological constitution, capacity, circumstances, history, and so on. And from here, Railton, so that leads us to objective interests in the following way. So whatever it is that Lonnie Plus wants for Lonnie, that's objectified subjective interest, which leads us to the objective interest, right? Which is basically the truth maker from that. So it's not the fact that Lonnie chooses it; it's that Lonnie chose it because that's the right thing. So the objective interest ends up being what Lonnie Plus, would choose.
So one thing I wanted to ask is the view that you're defending the claim that moral wrongness is identical to the property of not satisfying objective interests?
That's what Sinclair attributes to Railton.
Right. Are you defending that, or are you defending that?
Yes, I am defending that, but I add an exception to that, which is the following. Just give me one second here, I'm sorry. Okay, so therefore, the property of moral wrongness remains identical to not satisfying the objective interest of some groups of people, except when the capabilities of agents involved were being used at their maximum and there was no possible way the agent could have foreseen the situation, and such restrictions prevented the morally responsible agents from satisfying the group's objective interest. So the important part there is the last part. Such restrictions prevented the morally responsible agent from satisfying the group's objective interest. So the government may really want to feed all its people, for example, but if they don't have the means to do it, they shouldn't be morally accountable or held responsible for such a situation, unless it was their fault to begin with.
And so how do you get to that conclusion? You have an analogy you try to draw?
How do I get to the
conclusion that you can have this identity with the exception? Didn't you? You have an analogy or a similar kind of case you think shows this?
Yes, exactly. So the example that I give in the paper is okay. So let's say that you have two people drowning in front of you, right? There's a lake, and there's two people in front of you drowning, and let's say that, you know, Solani Plus, would want you to, in the situation, the way I have it set up is that you're only able to save one person because of the time frame that you have. So given that you're only able to save one person, you shouldn't be held morally accountable for not saving the other person. So under Sinclair's definition of moral wrongness, I think you would be accountable for both lives, even though physically you're only able to save one. And that's the analogy. So I have the ruling body example, then I have the drowning example. So that's my analogy. And then at the end, I end up saying, okay, so the moral wrongness condition that Sinclair is giving us is too strict, and this is how I amend it, which, so as long as the agent wasn't prevented from doing the morally right thing, which is satisfying the objective interests, then this at least puts Railton's view on a little bit stronger footing, even though it may be subjected to other attacks.
Excellent. So,
I think so I guess that's the end of my I guess official. So that's a paper in a nutshell, or in 15 minutes. So if we want to get to whatever you were gonna say plus your commentary.
Okay, yeah. So the first thing I wanted to start off with saying it's I like the topic. I'm very open to moral realism and naturalism in particular. And I don't know if I really buy Railton's account, to be honest with you, but I do.
Okay.
I do like the background picture of it. So basically what I take the background picture to be is that it's a picture about how you make these kinds of reductions. And the basic idea I think that he has is that we are able to identify one theoretical way of picking something out with another in virtue of the explanatory power that we get from
right.
doing so. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Sorry. I was just asking for a second. And so so that if you don't get explanatory power, then that shows that there's no identity there. And so the familiar case from water and H2O, I think, is important here. We have two sets of properties or two ways of picking stuff out, one by the kind of wateriness of water and one scientifically via concepts like hydrogen and oxygen and cationic bonding and stuff. And then the reason that we identify those two things and really say there's just one thing is because it allows us to explain a range of behavior. Like, for instance, we're able to explain why ice has a lower density than liquid water, or why it freezes, and we're able to understand that in a new way. So then that fuels our belief that there is an identity there. And I think Railton is trying to apply that model of reduction
Definitely.
To ethics. And so what's important for that project is that these properties have explanatory power. And so the first thing I wanted to ask you is if we take your line and say, suppose we buy your argument that moral wrongness is identical to this property, which I want to say something about in a second, but I want to start by asking this, what explanatory power or role does it have? And does it have the kind of explanatory power that's going to do the job necessary? So, for instance, when Sinclair's talking about satisfying objective interests, he's doing that because he thinks really that's the only thing that has explanatory power. So, in this case, though, that he's imagining, there's something else that's doing the explaining of the social unrest or something, or because it's not the fact that this is, well, here's a case where you have a dissatisfied interest, but you don't get the social unrest. So I just wonder, like, what's going on in that case explanatory-wise on your view?
So explanatory-wise, it seems that, right, so another part of Sinclair's paper, right, is, the paper is actually called Two Kinds of Naturalism in Ethics. So basically, Sinclair lays out two kinds of naturalism. So he doesn't call them anything. He just calls them, like, you know, basically case one and case two. Yeah, first kind, second kind. And the first kind is the Railton kind, right, where he has to, moral properties have to interact in good empirical theories, just like in the cases that you just explained, Richard. And the second kind is one where that condition he doesn't have to be met.
Right.
And in the paper, he goes on to saying that Railton's definitions, we can keep them in a way. We just kind of have to, you know, not attribute them this, you know, strong explanatory power that that Railton wanted to have. So the explanatory question. Go ahead.
I was just going to interject if I could. By the way, that would be, I mean, you could do that, but that would be a pretty heavy cost. To do, because then you would be saying, look, it's just sort of by mere miracle that these two things are identical and that we care about moral wrongness and moral rightness in the way that we do, but they don't play any explanatory role in why people behave the way they do or why society behaves the way that it does. So I think you could dig your heels in and say that, but that would be a pretty severe cost if you gave up the explanatory stuff. Or at least that's what I'm thinking. Someone like Railton is thinking.
Definitely. I think you're spot on with that. So I agree with that. So I'm trying to defend, you know, the first kind of naturalism and ethics. You know, whether I succeed or not, you know, that's you know.
Right. So then, what kind of explanatory role do you see that property that you?
Right. So Railton also has a. Okay, so let me start off by saying, so Railton thinks that, so I don't really go into this in my paper. He has the wants interest mechanism is what he calls. So the wants interest mechanism is basically the feedback condition whereby we can learn, you know, what moral rightness is. So I mean, morality wouldn't be morality if we're not able to attain it. So in the case of the ruling body, I think that people are coerced to accept such a proposition, such a condition, given the state of play in the world, in the example. So Railton also thinks that we're not always okay. So. Even though a dictator is doing all sorts of immoral things in a given country or in a given place, so even the people there don't rise up in all circumstances. Even though you know they really wish they could. So what's going on here, I think, in that case. So another problem with the case, I think, that I don't point out is that I think that it's very vague. It's very general, I think. But so even granting that, I think that what's going on here is that the people in such a situation just are coerced into this sort of thing to accept. So if these are the only two options, for example, option A and option B, you know, it's just a toss up between what you're going to choose. So I think that people there are restricted in a way that they shouldn't be restricted, or ideally wouldn't be restricted.
What does that explain about the way
moral wrongness works?
In Sinclair's example, we have a case, which I think is Railton talks about a lot too, but we have a case where there's some kind of social unrest.
Right.
There might be protests or outbursts or riots or something. And you would say, well, what explains what's going on there? And you might say, ah, well, here's what's going on there. There's somebody's objective needs that aren't being met, like their need for freedom or for self-expression or something like that.
Right.
That's not being met. And, oh, by the way, that's identical with moral wrongness. And so moral wrongness is explaining why there is this kind of unrest in those kinds of cases.
Right.
So in order to do that, it looks like it's got to be a certain kind of property.
Okay. Right. Well, so
your property, what you say. Look, moral wrongness is this. It's not satisfying objective interest unless there's no other way to do it, or unless there's no alternative.
Right.
So how can something like that play a role?
Okay.
In the way that something just like the non-disjunctive version or the non-conditional version would, because you don't normally find good empirical theories that have those kinds of, or maybe you do, I don't know, but one might think that you don't find good empirical theories that have those kinds of laws that say if this happens unless that.
Right. Yeah, and okay, now I think I'm starting to see what you're saying there.
And this goes, I don't know how familiar you are with the, philosophy of science literature, but this gets back to something like Jerry Fodor was talking about when he was arguing with Ned Block a long time ago about properties having to be projectable, and they can't be disjunctive. And so there's a whole debate about whether you can have disjunctive properties. And I'm not trying to say that, I have my intuitions. I think the arguments point against disjunctive properties, but other people disagree. But it sounds like what you're saying amounts to something like that. That really, what the property is this or something else. So I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that. Like, how do you conceive of this property that you're trying to pick out?
So it seems to me that. So what I thought that I was doing in the paper was, I'm adding this type of clause to what moral wrongness is, right? And I think that the memory literature, for example, in Martin and Deutscher's remembering, they have three conditions for memory, for example. I thought that's the same thing that I was doing in my, so I'm not, okay, so to answer your question, I'm not very familiar with the philosophy of science literature. So this is what, one of the deficits I think of the paper, one of the things that I also, I think that I don't properly answer Sinclair's probably main worry on here, even though I think that, I think I could work out the account so that I could, feasibly.
I mean, one thing that I would say about the memory kind of example is that there, what you're talking about is a process, or by which maybe you're not. I don't know. Maybe you're talking about a state of having a memory. But I mean, if you're talking about recalling a memory, and the conditions under which that thing would be a memory, so there it doesn't look like you're identifying a property, though, in the same way that you are when you're talking
about.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
Wrongness. And that does, I don't think that's like a fatal object or anything. It's just something to think about when you're like working on this.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Oh.
Because if, and I really do think that, that what Railton has in mind is something like, look, I'm picking out, I want to pick out some kind of property, and that's what moral wrongness is. And so you can put conditions on, so you said, well, sounds like what you want to do is give necessary and sufficient conditions for something being right or wrong. But what Railton is also trying to do is to identify the thing that's out there in the world, which is moral wrongness.
Right.
I mean, those types of things maybe can't be disjunctive. So I'm not sure. I don't know. Again, this would be something that I think that you would want to develop. I'm not sure what your thoughts were on it, which is why I was just trying to get you to sort of think out loud about how you were conceiving of this.
Yeah.
And then the explanatory work that you think this kind of property is. I mean, that's, I think, a way that this paper could be expanded is by adding stuff on that topic, since it's going to turn out to be really crucial, since I think that's really what Sinclair is after. He's really trying to say, look, you either get one or the other thing here. You get a property which does some explanatory work, but it turns out it's not, strictly speaking, identical with that thing. And whereby the model is, you know, if you say, I want to explain why that stuff over there behaves the way that it does, and I do that by postulating that it's H2O, unless it's something else. And then, so if somebody said that, water is H2O, unless this happens, in which case it's not H2O, you would start to say, okay, well, are you really talking about one thing here, or is this kind of like a jade nephrite thing, jadeite nephrite, or really what you thought was a unitary thing is multiple things. Frankie, I knew she would object at some point. But no barking, Frankie. So all I'm trying to do is get you to think more about the metaphysics of it and
right.
What the conditions are for counting something.
Since
it's supposed to be a metaphysical view, and I thought you were trying to advance a view about what the categorical basis for moral wrongness was, rather than just giving conditions for when something counts as...
So you're right. I did try to go for the categorical basis. I just don't think that I end up doing a very good job at it. in the end, which is definitely something that I wrestled with the last time. I'm currently wrestling with. So definitely I want to get into more of the explanatory account literature, and
Sorry about that. Go ahead.
It's okay. I've been looking a little bit at Sinclair. Oh, hi. That's Frankie, right?
Yeah, that's Frankie. No, Frankie. Go ahead, though. Sorry, go ahead.
Sinclair has this moral explanations project at University of Nottingham. Which is something that I definitely think I should look into, and the work that he's trying to do there. I think we're about a half an hour here. Let me just do some closing remarks here. I want to look more into into his moral explanations project and try to more adequately respond to him. I still think. I guess at the end of the day, it's this perhaps my unfounded intuition that I can make this definition that I'm working out a viable one. I think I can do it from Railton's perspective, and if I get it more into the literature of explanatory accounts and that sort of thing, I definitely think I could do more with that, and I thank you, Richard, for definitely pointing me in that direction.
Oh yeah, it was my pleasure. I enjoyed reading the paper. I think it's a good project, so I think you're on an interesting track. I'd be interested to see where you end up.
thank you, and thank you everyone for listening to our talk.
Very cool. All right, and with that,